The question is simple. Should you consider an iPhone 15 to be a realistic contender for professional quality video capture? Does it actually measure up to the rest of cinema cameras? And if so, is there a way we can even measure it? Well, this is a DSC XYLA step chart. It's an instrument capable of measuring the dynamic range of any camera. If we profile an iPhone 15 and plot the results on the chart, we can evaluate the sensitivity of iPhone 15 and compare its dynamic range to any other camera. So the question now is, how good is Apple Log? Well, before we can measure the sensitivity of an iPhone, we need to first configure it to behave like a cinema camera, at least as much as possible. Add cages, adapters, lenses, motors, and wireless video. Bring it on a real set with lights, props, and performers. Put the iPhone rig on some sticks, a slider, clap a slate, and see if an iPhone cinema setup that costs less than $2,000 can actually perform like one that costs, well, a whole lot more. But look at it. It did. But why? What's happening here? I'm not trying to manufacture results. These are real, and they shocked me too. When did iPhone get to the point that it can capture images like this? How are the images of an iPhone able to look this good? And why does it even matter? Well, to answer those questions, we need to go back to where all this iPhone cinema camera nonsense started. iPhone 15 was released at the end of September 2023. So in October, we began experimenting with Apple's latest cinema mode camera technology. Back in episode 11, we did an initial breakdown in which we compared cinema mode to a 46mm large format Red Monstro sensor. You should check out episode 11 for the full analysis. Like any experiment, we didn't know what to expect, but they provided impressive results. But they also sparked some new questions. The biggest issue with that test were limitations of Apple's real-time spatial analysis, which had visible edge artifacts due to its real-time simulated depth of field processing. But your feedback from episode 11 inspired us to keep testing. So then, in episode 18, cinematographer Shannon Stutenroth and I tried to push iPhone further by using AI depth of field technology to analyze images, identify spatial distances, and apply controlled, realistic blurs to simulate more accurate depth of field. The biggest advantage here is that we were now able to use ProRes in Apple Log, which unlocked a massive improvement in quality. But while Apple ProRes in Log improved the quality, we still ran into limitations that produced artifacts around fine edges. But we're making progress. And again, your comments inspired a third test, which Shannon and I did in episode 23.
After the first iPhone test we did, I was really amazed with the footage. However, we didn't use any sort of glass in front of the iPhone camera. This time we linked up with BeastGrip and Atlas, and we used a depth of field adapter to get more of a cinema look and push the lens options that are in front of an iPhone camera and how we can achieve depth of field without having to use AI and actually see if we can make it look like it would be anamorphic on a cinema camera.
Ultimately, we're very happy with the images that came out. But don't miss this. The same phone we started with that had okay results is now generating images that are way better than okay. In fact, the reason we keep doing these tests is because after each one, we realize we haven't yet hit the limits of what we think iPhone 15 is capable of. Every time we shoot with it, we think we can make it better. And as we got more comfortable with each test, we got more ambitious with each production. But the best way to challenge all this new technology is to couple it with the talent of a great crew. And when it comes to lighting this set, that story is best told by an amazing gaffer.
My name is Jacob Abrams, and I am a gaffer. So I'm the guy who takes what's on camera and creates the color and the texture with my paintbrushes of lights to create the mood of the scene.
Down slowly. Right there, hold that.
The relationship with the production designer and the DP and myself and the key grip, we're all trying to achieve the common goal of creating the look we want and just using different tools to get there. And the cinematographer is really the one guiding that vision. And then we'll all kind of get together and look at the monitor and say, like, okay, if we make this little adjustment to where this painting's hung or where this box is, does that get us closer to our ultimate goal of the mood we want to create?
Even though it goes without saying, because this is YouTube, I have to say it. Talent is everything. A souped-up iPhone will not automatically make a pretty picture. But what's new here is that a souped-up iPhone is finally capable of capturing one. Do you see the difference? A better iPhone doesn't mean that it replaces other great tools to shoot with, but it does mean that Apple is moving up the ladder of available camera options that one day will find themselves on a list of options for more and more people to use. And if you're strongly against the idea of using iPhones to shoot professional video, you might still agree that having more choices overall is a good thing. And that got me thinking, if all the right talent and all the right lighting equipment are there, then what's the number one attribute of iPhone 15 that contributes the most to making great pictures? Is it the BeastGrip depth of field adapter? Is it the Atlas Mercury anamorphic lenses? Is it the Apple ProRes codec? Is it 4K resolution? Is it Jacob and Shannon's lighting or Nick LaRoe's color correction? The easy answer is yes to all these. But while there are a lot of components that make up a great image, if I had to boil it down to one reason that iPhone 15 is performing so well, it's dynamic range. So what is that and how do we measure it? Well, to do that, we need to go back to that xylophone looking thing from the beginning. This is a XYLA chart and it's made by DSC Labs. DSC are the gold standard in calibration and testing video equipment. A XYLA chart is an easy way to evaluate how many stops of dynamic range a camera can capture. So how does it work? Well, first we have to understand how to measure light. The perception of light is not linear, rather it's logarithmic. Well, what does that mean? Well, when we think about increasing the brightness of something, we tend to think in terms of addition. So for example, let's imagine one candle lighting a dark room. Then we add a second candle. We instantly sense that the ambient light generated is now twice as bright. So let's add a third candle. That means we have three times the brightness, right? Wrong. Because light perception is logarithmic, if we want to double the brightness from two candles, we actually need four. And if we want to double the brightness again, it's not gonna happen with five or six or even seven, but eight. Doubling it again requires 16 candles and so on. This is because perception of light is not additive, it's multiplicative. It also means the difference between each stop is actually quite a bit of light. Look at this image properly exposed. Reducing the light by one stop means we actually lose quite a bit of brightness. Increasing the light by only one stop becomes too much. So armed with this information, we can use a XYLA chart to determine a camera's dynamic range by viewing how many independent stops of light it can see. If we look closer at the XYLA chart, we're not actually seeing a gradient. Each shutter panel isolates its own built-in light source, and each slice represents one complete stop. We can use a slide to cover up the stops when testing to avoid veiling glare from the brightest stop, which can contaminate low-end stops in the toe. We know that low dynamic range cameras see maybe 10 stops, and super high dynamic range cameras can see closer to 20. So where does iPhone 15 land? Well, for fun, I wanted to include a benchmark that shows us how far we've come. So we decided to start the test with my iPhone 6. This iPhone represents Apple camera technology from 10 years ago. At first glance on the XYLA chart, there's not a lot there. Back then, phones could only capture video as H.264, and video files were gamma-corrected H.264 files, which means the contrast is already baked in, and the compression was fairly high. So we can artificially lift the brightness to see what's happening in the shadows. This is not impacting the test, rather it allows us to see into the shadows a little better by counteracting baked-in gamma. With this result, we can count 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 stops, and then maybe the hint of 11. If we look at the waveform, we can see in RGB mode, there is proper exposure on the top end, the brightest chip. It's also clear that H.264 compression is compromising this result a bit, and stop 11 isn't really a true stop, so it looks like iPhone 6 is on the board with a dynamic range of about 10 stops. Now let's get into some more modern products. This is the iPhone 13. Right away, we can see a lot more XYLA chips, and the image looks a lot cleaner. We can see 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, and 12 with the faintest hint of 13. Now let's switch to iPhone 14, where we actually see a very similar result. 10, 11, 12, and yeah, slightly clearer 13. Now even though iPhone 13 and 14 seem to have about the same dynamic range, what I can see here is that iPhone 14 may have an improvement in signal-to-noise ratio. This indicates that Apple may have reduced the compression and improved the noise floor through artificial image processing to clean up dirty blacks. This is a common practice in enhancing images. And even though it's subtle, there is a slight improvement on the 14, but they both are on the board with 13 stops. But before we go to iPhone 15, I wanted to try one more thing. Let's measure some vintage digital cinema technology. Shannon set up my old Red One camera. according to the log, the last time I used this was in May of 2013. And to my surprise, without a hiccup, the red one booted right away and it worked perfectly. This thing is a tank. Now, this model has the Mysterium X upgraded sensor, which was Red's second sensor, but it still worked in the original Red One body. It was one of the most sensitive low light sensors of the time. In fact, I worked on the very first movie to shoot on the MX sensor, which was The Social Network. Cinematographer Jeff Cronenwith rated the camera at ISO 600, which lowered the noise floor even more, making for a very clean look. And on that film, he earned an Oscar nomination for Best Cinematography. So how much dynamic range was the MX sensor capable of? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, and the slightest indication of an additional stop. So the Red One MX, a 14-year-old camera, can see 13 stops and maybe a half stop more. Again, for a cinema solution in 2010, this was a real breakthrough. So that leaves us with the newest iPhone 15. Now, the biggest difference here is that iPhone 15 is no longer limited to recording images with baked-in gamma. Recently, Apple introduced to the phones Apple Log. Log encoding means dynamic range captured by a sensor when converted to video is mapped on a logarithmic scale instead of a linear one. To explain this, imagine representing the dynamic range of a camera as a solid line that delivers 10 stops of dynamic range from 0 to 100. If the sensor improved to 12 stops, the line would have to be longer. But since pure white is still limited to 100, we can't just plot that data in linear fashion because it would go off the scale. So instead, we can bend the line to make it longer, effectively using a logarithmic plot to create more room to store additional data. This also provides colorists with more range and flexibility when manipulating the images in post. iPhone 15 is the first smartphone to introduce log encoding, which I expect is largely responsible for the images that we're seeing from the phone. So in addition to capturing images in log, we have another advantage in Apple ProRes as the capture codec, which encodes video around 450 megabits per second at 10-bit color sampling. This means there's virtually no compression artifacts, and it's these three components, 10-bit color, log encoding, and ProRes compression that should work together to deliver high dynamic range as well as a cleaner signal. So let's see. Remember, iPhone 6 topped out around 10 stops. iPhone 13 and 14 clocked in around 12. Red One was 13 and a half. And iPhone 15, well, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, and there's 13. And well, I'd say that's a solid 14. Wow. 14 stops. Compared to where we started, this means the dynamic range of an iPhone 15 is pushing 4 more stops of dynamic range than an iPhone 6. The difference here is actually enormous. If we look back at the XYLA and compare all the tests together, we can see how big the difference really is. There's no change to the ambient lighting in the room or the XYLA itself. It's just what each sensor can see, all starting with proper exposure of the brightest chip one. This helps explain why iPhone 15 is capable of capturing such great images. But let's not kid ourselves. We all know that iPhone isn't the best camera out there. The latest red sensor in the new Raptor camera can see 18 stops. This means a red Raptor has more than double the total dynamic range of an iPhone 6 and has a third more overall dynamic range than an original Red One MX. So with all these measurements, why does it matter? Well, because it explains why we didn't have any issues lighting the iPhone on our set. When you're working with limited dynamic range, you actually have to work harder to control the shadows and highlights of your lighting in order for it to be balanced and to look good. And we expected that to be the case, but when our gaffer Jacob began lighting, he noticed something about his approach.
So when I started was right when the Red One came out. It was surprisingly easy to make that look bad if you didn't know what you were doing. It's kind of funny actually comparing it to what we're doing today with the iPhone, where it's almost easier than when I was first working with the Red One. lighting a set on an iPhone is always an interesting challenge because it does require you to light things differently. And there's things that we're experimenting with in this case, which are creating more depth and more Z-axis by using highlights selectively. It's almost shocking how much depth we're able to create with a set that isn't very physically deep and on an iPhone, which is traditionally a very deep depth of field tool. So to create this vintage look and make it look authentic, the big thing is mixing the practical lights with our modern LED movie lights. And we're using the incandescent traditional globes on a dimmer pack so I can control it from the iPad. Besides the practical lights, we ended up using about 10 or 12 traditional film fixtures to light the set.
Oh yeah, it looks really good.
Okay, that's better.
I think the biggest key to make an iPhone look really good is assembling a really good team that works together well. The iPhone is really able to do it justice with all this new technology to make it really feel like a digital cinema camera in ways that just I've never seen possible before.
So there you have it. Talent lives at the heart of any production, and iPhone 15 captures it with enough quality to respect the effort of a talented crew. Now, my interest in this is not to convince you that iPhone is the best camera out there. Clearly, it's not. But there are two things that I think are important to consider. First, iPhone is the most readily available camera to people on a global scale. In terms of high dynamic range, 4K ProRes, 10-bit log encoded cameras with built-in monitors, lenses, and batteries, I'm pretty sure that iPhone 15 is the only camera that delivers all those features for less than $1,200. For many creatives, affordability matters, and so you have to start somewhere. iPhone's a good place. But the second reason that I'm interested in this is not that I'm switching to iPhone to shoot all my projects. Rather, this test tells me that Apple is making improvements to iPhone faster than some other camera companies are. For the last few years, upgrades to the iPhone video tools have seen tremendous innovation. That simply means if Apple chooses to continue innovating on this path, we'll see major upgrades to the sensors, lenses, applications, and hardware integrations that make it a stronger ecosystem. So I asked at the beginning of this episode, why does this matter? And the reason is this: whenever you can sense the acceleration of innovation in a space that you work in, pay attention. It's an early indicator that something special may be happening. So arm yourself early so you can fully take advantage of how that innovation may add value to your craft.